Thank you so much to all of you for joining us this evening. I'm just going to say a few words about myself and maybe a few words about this course, because I was going to try to do the first session, actually, because the course was my idea, but then the diaries didn't work out. So you're kind of getting the introduction to the series in the second session rather than the first session, but it doesn't really matter. So my name is Rabbi Lea Mühlstein. I'm one of the rabbis at the Ark Synagogue, which many of you will be more familiar with as NPLS, our previous name, Northwood and Pinner Liberal Synagogue. I was ordained at Leo Beck College, but I actually am originally from Germany. I was born and raised in Germany. So the story of Rabbi Regina Jonas, who we're talking about, is very close to my heart. The idea of the series was really to think about the different contributions of Jewish women throughout the ages. And I just put this out to my liberal colleagues and said, wouldn't it be fascinating if we just did a series on Jewish women throughout the ages? And you can pick whoever you like. And I think what's so wonderful about what has come out of it as a series is the variety of different women that we'll be looking at. And one of the reasons why I wanted to look at Jewish women and why I chose the title Forgotten Lives is that I think what we find very often is that the lives of women or the contribution of women was forgotten. And in many ways, actually, the story of Rabbi Regina Jonas is very symbolic of that. And we'll see that in a little moment. I've got a few slides, and we'll also hopefully watch a short little film. It's just 10 minutes long. So I'm going to just share my screen with you for a moment. So the person we're talking about today is Rabbi Regina Jonas. If we look at her, actually the title that she preferred, and she was very specific about this, we know this from the archives, was Fräulein Rabbina Regina Jonas. So Rabbi Rabbina in German. Why Fräulein? Fräulein, for those of you who are familiar with the German language, normally indicates an unmarried woman. But actually here, it wasn't just to indicate her marital status, but because Frau Rabbina was the title given to the Rebbetzin, to the wife of the rabbi. So the choice of Fräulein Rabbina Regina Jonas was also very much about saying, I am a rabbi, I earn that title, I am not the spouse of a rabbi. Now, the life of Rabbi Regina Jonas, unfortunately, was cut very short. She was born in 1902 and died in 1944 in Auschwitz. She was murdered in Auschwitz. But nonetheless, I think her contribution is one that is really important, albeit that it was forgotten for a really long time. So one of the things that I want us to do in this session is to think a little bit about what does it mean that we forgot about the fact that there was a woman ordained in already the 1930s in Germany who had a contribution, who made a significant contribution, and all memory of her seemed to have been lost for quite some time. And I think that is one of the aspects that is worth for us exploring. Let's just very briefly, before we look at a little bit at her biography, I want to just share one of the quotes from her writings. We have, which came to light actually only after the fall of the Berlin Wall. We have in the archives in what used to be East Germany, a collection of papers by Rabbi Regina Jonas, which survived the war. It's not quite clear why we have the selection that we have. It's clear that it's only a selection of her writings and not all of her writings. But we have a selection of her writings, possibly selected by her, possibly selected by others. And I thought it's useful for us to start with her own words as we think about her life. This is from a passage which she wrote in the Zentralverein Zeitung, which was one of the Jewish papers at the time. And it's from June 23, 1938. So it's also, of course, important for us to keep in mind the historical context here. But so this is 3 years after her ordination in 1938. And she writes, "I hope a time will come for all of us in which there will be no more questions on the subjects of woman. For as long as there are questions, something is wrong. But if I must say what drove me as a woman to become a rabbi, two elements come to mind: my belief in the godly calling and my love for people. God has placed abilities and callings in our hearts without regard to gender. Thus, each of us has the duty, whether man or woman, to realize those gifts God has given. If you look at things this way, one takes woman and man for what they are, human beings." Some really strong, powerful words that very much acknowledge the place that she had, the unique place that she had as a woman who was ordained as a rabbi, the only woman to be ordained as a rabbi at the time. But at the same time saying very clearly, the reason I became a rabbi was my calling and my love for people. So it wasn't that she wasn't necessarily, while she was a feminist in a certain sense, she wasn't a feminist activist. Interestingly, if we look at the writings that we have of her, she wasn't even very much of a liberal rabbi. So she was actually relatively conservative in her interpretation, even compared to her contemporaries. So if we compare it to her contemporaries in Germany, we have to remember the 1930s in Germany were really the heyday of Reform Judaism, right? Reform Judaism had won out. the Orthodox synagogues, there's a debate in Munich, actually. I happen to know it because I grew up in Munich. There was a debate in Munich where the Orthodox community were begging the main community, which was the Reform community, for some space to be allowed to hold prayers. So it's this paradox. So really here is the heyday of liberal Judaism. And she really wasn't very much of a liberal Jew in that regard. She was quite traditional in many of her interpretations. Her rabbinic thesis, which is about can women be ordained, and it's now available in translation, although I don't actually have an English translation of it, but it was now translated into English, the whole thesis, is very traditionally oriented. Many, many quotes from the Talmud, really trying to find some very, very traditional sources for her reasoning and for her arguments of, you know, this is why she wants to be a rabbi. And for example, one of the things that I think is quite fascinating, one of the quotes from the thesis is she has an entire section about women and beauty and makeup. And so I'm going to share, this is another quote that I want to share with you. So in her rabbinic thesis, which actually she writes the thesis already in 1930, I will say a little bit more about kind of her formal ordination in a moment. So in her rabbinic thesis, one of the things she talks about is she says, certainly the woman believed that self-decoration and beauty were the most important matters, because the overarching philosophy of life considered beauty, marriage, and motherhood to be her main sphere of activity. Unfortunately, it turned out that there is too much emphasis placed on appearance and beauty. And such an interpretation of the woman's life in this regard must clearly lead to superficiality with no room for serious spiritual work. Moreover, the Talmud is too accepting of her artificial beautification. See, for example, the Babylonian Talmud, Moed Katan 9b, where it says, the rabbis taught the following are the woman's beauty items. She may decorate her eyes, do her hair, and anoint her face. So what she recognizes here very, very strongly is this societal place of woman and of beauty as a way of kind of distracting, in a sense, woman from being able to engage in the world. And that even our tradition, our religious tradition kind of reinforced that. And I think it's, when I read this, I think how very contemporary, right? I just got, somebody gave me as a present, feminist postcards. And because the patriarchy isn't going to fight itself, and one of the feminist postcards in here is the patriarchy needs the beauty standard, because when we are focused on getting a beach body, we are too busy to think about smashing the system. So this is, you know, 2021. And the quote that I just shared with you is 1930. So while she doesn't in a certain sense define herself as a feminist and isn't formally affiliated with the feminist movement, we see here very, very clearly that actually what she's trying to do is create systematic change, is to get people to think about systematic change. She's not just saying we need to rethink who woman is, but we need to also think about the things that keep woman in her place. And that this focus about beauty and makeup, you know, maybe there is nothing wrong with a bit of makeup, but that can lead to women being held in their place and not being able to fulfill their potential. If we think a little bit, I introduced her kind of with a few of her quotes. If we come back a little bit to her biography, then what we see is that she is, we don't know very much about her very early days. So as a child, none of the documents are available anymore. There were no documents of about her childhood. She first really appears in the records in the 1920s, when she joins the Hochschule für die Wissenschaft des Judentums. So she begins her studies at the Hochschule für die Wissenschaft des Judentums in 1926, at the age of 24. And she enrolls initially into a program where she is not the only woman. She is one, I think, of 36 women, if I'm not mistaken. I might need to check the exact number. Yes, I think she's one of 26 women. She enrolls in this program, really embarking on a journey to become a teacher in in the Jewish community. So most women that will have been on this path will be on the teacher path. But it's, we know from later documents that actually relatively early on, she speaks about the fact that already as early as 11, she starts thinking that she might want to be a rabbi. And so she begins already thinking about wanting to be a rabbi, and she really seeks out teachers. One of her beloved teachers with whom we know she had a very close relationship, because there are letters remaining, was Ismael Bogen. Anyone who has studied liturgy will know that Elbogen wrote the kind of reference work about the Jewish service, about Jewish liturgy. And Elbogen, together with another teacher at the Hochschule für die Wissenschaft des Judentums, really supported her on this path of engaging in further study. And there is a beautiful letter from 1927 during Purim, where Elbogen writes to Regina Jonas that she shouldn't be too pessimistic about getting work if she were ever to be ordained. So already then, in 1927, we see there are also men who are engaging in this thinking. Now, unfortunately, Elbogen dies very early. He dies in 1943. He emigrates to the United States, but dies in 1943. So he was not around either anymore to maintain that memory of her life. But Jonas sticks with her studies. So after studying for the teaching qualification, she continues her studies, and she takes the exam, the ordination exam, as well as writing her rabbinic thesis in 1930 on can women be ordained. In 1935, there is a debate, should we ordain a woman? And in the end, the Hochschule für die Wissenschaft des Judentums, although it was a liberal institution, decides that it is not possible to ordain her. So the institute where she has studied, where she has taken her exam, says, we are just not ready for you. And it's an interesting thing that unfortunately we see duplicated through the ages. So one of the stories, for example, that one of my teachers, Rabbi Sheila Shulman, for example, told is that, you know, when she and Rabbi Eli Tikva Sarah were admitted to Leobek College as the first openly lesbian women, they felt that they had hanging over them for the entire 5 years, that they weren't sure that they were actually going to be ordained. That, you know, you would be allowed to study, but would it in the end, would somebody really sign your smicha? And it turns out that in the end for Rabbi Regina Jonas, actually the reason why her smicha, why she never received smicha from the Hochschule für die Wissenschaft des Judentums, is that one Talmud teacher refuses to sign the smicha. And it is one man who refuses to give the smicha. It is also one man who in the end grants her smicha, Max Dienemann, who was one of the more liberal of the liberal rabbis, decides to ordain her privately and grant her smicha in December 1935. And Leo Beck, who at the time was, you're probably most familiar with the name Leo Beck from the Leo Beck College, but who at the time was the head of kind of the Berlin Jewish community, which was an Einheitsgemeinde. So it did have also Orthodox and more conservative elements within it. He doesn't sign the smicha, but a couple of years later, he signs a letter which says this is a true copy of the ordination certificate. And in fact, this is the only proof of the ordination that we have. So her original ordination certificate seems to have been lost. But we have this letter from Leo Beck that confirms this is a true copy of the ordination certificate, which he signed. So you know, we can debate, did he in the end decide, actually, you know, maybe I made a mistake initially that I didn't push it, and therefore I should have maybe thought about it. But nonetheless, it is interesting that we see that she is, after this, forgotten. She is, in 1942, she is deported to Terezin. She works in the Jewish community. She becomes more and more active. Before she is deported to Terezin, she becomes more and more active, because as the Jewish community in Berlin shrinks, and as more and more rabbis, male rabbis, go into immigration, suddenly there is lots of vacancies for her, right? And suddenly, while at first she mostly finds employment as a chaplain, and she was very active in hospital chaplaincy, later on she becomes more and more active as a working rabbi. And there are people, there were people who remembered her as a working rabbi in the community, that she was somebody who people had awareness of her. She comes to Theresienstadt, and there also very much acts in a pastoral capacity. In Theresienstadt, we have some sermons, we'll come back to them after the short little movie as well. Sorry, one second, for some reason my doorbell is ringing, but I will just ignore it. So she in Theresienstadt too, she is very active. She looks after the community. She has pastoral duties. She acts as a rabbi. She preaches. We have one sermon from her. I'll share an extract of that later on. But in 1944, she is murdered in Auschwitz. And for many, many years, her memory disappears. I think at this point, I want to go to the little movie. Because it sort of picks up, it's a short film that was produced in kind of capturing a trip where I think it was the Jewish archives, the World Jewish Archives, decided to take a group of primarily women rabbis who were kind of the first back to Berlin and in the footsteps of Rabbi Regina Jonas, and they kind of capture her that journey in this short 10-minute film. So I'm going to, hopefully what will happen is that I will disappear, and instead of me, the movie will come. And what I want you to do is just enjoy the movie, listen to it, see what you think, and just keep thinking while you're watching. Keep thinking a little bit about kind of how do we explain what happened that she really was so forgotten, and then maybe we can come together and think a little bit together about what we think that means and what does that mean about how we remember history as well. So hopefully the movie will start.
Now. Regina Jonas had the passion and the desire to become a rabbi when it was completely new. She faced a lot of antagonism. She had no role models. They were all men. And yet there was something inside of her that moved her forward.
People made such a fuss about us of how did you possibly imagine that you could be a rabbi, and it, you know, wasn't possible. So now that I learned that she was born in 1902 and as an 11-year-old discerned that she was supposed to be a rabbi, in 1913 in Germany. What an absolutely remarkable story, regardless of the rest of the story.
Well, I think one of the great gifts of feminism is discovering all these stories that have been hidden away for so long. And Regina Jonas is one of those people we should have known about.
And here she lived when she was already officiating as a teacher and preacher.
Rabbinical. I think Regina Jonas changes how we think about Jewish history to recognize that the first woman who became a rabbi here in Berlin in December of 1935. It shifts the kind of narrative that we tell about feminism. It makes the post-war feminist movement, which we associate very much with the United States, actually to have roots that go back further.
This is it. This is her whole life in a box.
I think the most powerful moment for me was when we were with the archivist and you could see Regina Jonas' papers. And there weren't very many of them. But in some sense, it appears that she chose those papers. So in a way, she was creating how she wanted to be remembered.
And I told before that we don't know exactly how these papers got here. We think she gave them to the Jewish community before she was sent to Theresienstadt, so about in 1942. And then
we just have a fragment. We only have a fragment. But how wonderful that we do have that fragment.
We have the original ordination that letter, so to speak. And Leo Beck signs it, not signing the smicha, but signing that it's a true copy. Which means he was doing some political, I think, some political balancing. He was the head of all of German Jewry, so he couldn't say, you know, I'm ordaining a woman in 35. This would have been problematic, but he took that step as far as he could. Nobody knowing about her, even though Leo Beck knew her and survived, and many other people knew her and survived, didn't talk about her. So this is kind of the weird... Right. Silencing women. For me, it's writing women out of history.
It's an evening of firsts in which we honor Regina Jonas, the first woman rabbi in modern times, and bring together for the very first time the pioneering rabbis who were the first to be ordained by their denominational seminaries.
I was always pleased that I wasn't really first, because I never wanted to be. So I knew that maybe there was a woman who had some form of ordination. We weren't sure of her name even, but the rumor was there.
I do a lot of speaking, and I always try to mention her, feeling that whenever we gather to talk about these kinds of subjects, we bring honor to her memory.
Thank you. so many pilgrimages up mountains. Now at Terezin with Regina, a different pilgrimage on sanctified ground.
She was the pastor. She was the teacher. She was their rabbi. And to be in that place with other women rabbis, which are her legacy, was quite powerful to me.
This is from an article that she wrote in 1938. God has placed abilities and callings in our hearts without regard to gender. Thus, each of us has the duty, whether man or woman, to realize those gifts God has given. If you look at things this way, one takes woman and man for what they are, human beings.
The texts that she was looking at were the same texts that I had been thinking about in terms of finding support for female rabbis.
I believe that the question of whether a woman may make halachic decisions as a rabbinirin may very clearly be seen as permitted, and it is not necessary to continue to linger over this matter.
For a second, it was, could I have done what she did? No, I don't think I could have done what she did, but for a moment I had a glimpse of it because I was speaking her words.
The words on the plaque that come from one of her sermons that have somehow miraculously survived. To live that kind of a life, I think, makes her a symbol for all humanity.
It's a little bit like reconnecting with a long-lost relative, older relative that I always should have known, who's part of my story, whom I had never even known about.
She ministered to people at a time of such grave crisis and inhumanity, and yet she not only kept her own spirits and faith going, she kept the faith going of those who were imprisoned there. That's what a rabbi does, is to try and offer hope in the darkest of times.
I just can't even believe that her papers were hidden away for 50 years and that nobody really talked about her. So I have to say to myself, was her story kept from us because she's a woman? And then I start to wonder about how many other stories have been kept from us?
So I want to give us an opportunity to have a bit of a conversation also with each other, and for you to maybe share kind of your impressions of the film, but also any comments in terms of on your life, and especially to think a little bit about this question of how could it be that there was a woman who was ordained, that there were others who knew about her, who continued their life in the Jewish community, who chose to forget her, or who just forgot her, or forgot to mention her, or didn't really talk about her. So I'm gonna allow you to unmute yourself. So really anyone, just unmute yourself and share your reflections. Ellie, I can see you've got yourself off mute. Nope.
I think it's, I first learned about her in my conversion class. And I was so hurt that, you know, that woman's history had just been hidden or obliterated or not thought important enough to keep going. I think I felt, as a woman, I felt really, really hurt. I felt yet another woman kept out of history. And I reflected that she, you know, her vocation to be a rabbi and what that meant to her was amazing. So, sorry, I'm very croaky. What were you?
Yeah, you're fine.
That's my reflection on her.
Thank you. Thank you. And I can see Jackie had her hand up, and then Liz, and then Alexandra. So Jackie.
What I didn't get was where were the records discovered, and how did they come about so that we could work back and say that she'd been forgotten or deliberately forgotten? What happened that made the records come out?
Okay, so the main thing that happened was the fall of the Berlin Wall, which opened a lot of the archives in Eastern Germany to scholars. Now, there wasn't really actually any reason why you couldn't have gone into these archives. So her archives are in a small town about 100 kilometers away from Berlin. It's not quite clear why they ended up there. We don't quite know. Potentially the Jewish community decided, you know, maybe there was an archivist there in the 30s who wasn't going to destroy the Jewish papers, so they ended up there. We're not quite sure. But after the fall of the Berlin Wall and the end of communism, people started to go more into these archives. There were, as Rabbi Jackie Tabak says in the movie, there were people who sort of said, I think there once was a woman who was ordained. So it was a kind of rumor. Now, it's very interesting. So Rabbi Eli Tikvasero wrote an essay also on Rabbi Regina Jonas. And in that essay, she quotes a conversation that she has with a colleague. He's no longer with us now, I think. I think he just recently died, actually. Rabbi Curtis Castle, who was a classmate of Rabbi Regina Jonas. She asked him, why did you never talk about Rabbi Regina Jonas? Like, why do you not, did she not leave a lasting impression? Or, apparently he just replied saying, oh, I didn't like her very much and I wasn't very interested in her. So
not the slightest bit judgmental. Okay.
So I think part of it was, you know, it was no longer opportune. Like, we don't know why Leo Beck, for example, didn't talk about her. I mean, Leo Beck, you know, when he was in England, he was very much in the Reform context. It wasn't that he was sort of a rabbi for all and everybody, he should have had to hide it. But we have no, he died before anyone could ask him. But it just wasn't opportune. I think it was the sort of thing you could just forget about it. So even we know, for example, that Rabbi Leo Beck's wife was very close friends with Rabbi Regina Jonas, because there are letters from the 1930s that they wrote to each other. And she didn't ever speak about her either. So it's a very complicated story. It's probably partly linked to this, what maybe it's difficult for us to appreciate, or certainly for me to appreciate like now, is that there probably was a sort of atmosphere, well, in the war years, things were possible for women that just shouldn't have been possible. We see this also in the Protestant church. The Protestant church ordained many women and had them in preachers' roles during the war years. And as soon as the war ended and the men came back, they all got fired. So part of that probably was this, you know, you just kind of, you put the genie back into the box. It was sort of, a genie came out, but you put it back into the box. But it's very, very difficult for us to know now. The reason why we now know so much is that the archives are accessible again. So I've got Liz first, and then Alexandra, and then after that, Xinwu.
Okay, well, my comment is, I'm just wondering, all right, we say now she was ordained in 1935, but maybe the ordination wasn't quite recognized by other people even then, or somehow not taken seriously. I mean, maybe as an aspect of sexism that, all right, some people say she's a rabbi, but we don't really think she's a rabbi, so we're not going to worry about it. That kind of thing.
So I'm sure that was partly the case. Although we have one of the photos that we have, I'm going to see if I can find it and share it on the screen. Is one of the photos we have is actually of a of an advertisement from 1938 of her speaking, and we see there, let me just put the screen share up. We see there very clearly that, is that now showing the Neue Synagoge picture, the Haftalah thing? So we see there very clearly at the bottom here that it says the Ansprache hält, so the lecture or the sermon, Fräulein Rabbiner Jonas. So very, very clearly that actually within the Jewish community and Neue Synagoge, Oranienburger Straße, right? That was, if you think of that iconic building in Berlin, that is that synagogue. That was the main kind of, or one of the main synagogues. So maybe not everyone accepted her, but nonetheless, there was a very clear indication in society that, that she was accepted as a rabbi, and there was controversy. So we have an article, for example, from the time. I'm just trying to find that that quote. So in 1931 in the Jewish journal Israelitisches Familienblatt, an anonymous, I think it's an anonymous writer, writes. One is rightfully permitted to be proud of her. One is rightfully permitted to see this as a good sign of the times when a young woman, out of her own inclination and zeal, grasps hold of the Jewish teaching profession. But nevertheless, it strikes us that in this certificate, which the Hochschule for the Science of Judaism has bestowed, and in this case, he's only talking about her academic teaching certificate, it was not stated explicitly that it is only a teaching and not a preaching certificate. As long as it is not the regular norm that women ministers are appointed, and as long as many small communities give people with academic religion certificates rabbinic functions, it must be said that this diploma, when bestowed on a woman, should not include the qualification to preach, which normally a certificate like this includes. Otherwise, it could happen that other academic and seminary educated women religion teachers could climb the pulpit and claim to be qualified by their educational institutions to do so. So there was controversy, but it wasn't that nobody knew about it, right? So it was clearly out there. It was clearly something different to the norm. But it was very much part of the mainstream dialogue. Alexandra first, then Xinwu, and then I have David Simmons, and I think Rachel as well.
Yeah, hi, guten Abend. For me, it resonates very much with my grandmother. I'm having to convert now because my grandmother married a German fighter pilot, navigator. He fell in love with her. His dad then got papers for my grandmother to hide that she was Jewish. I have no idea where my grandmother came from, who, you know, what her original sort of where she's come from. I only found out from a blood test that, you know, that I'm Jewish, and then things just pieced together, like, you know, Saturday, the whole family was over for dinner. Fridays, if it was me and her, we had special candle time, you know, and I'm sort of thinking, you know, it was hidden also, just like Regina Jonas. And I'm voting with my feet now, and my daughters are voting with their feet. You know, we are Jewish and we should stand up for that. And yeah, I just thought it was quite important to sort of bring this up as well.
Thank you. Yeah, very, very interesting. Xinwu, and then David, and then Rachel.
Oh, hi. I just wanted to sort of add to when someone said that it's very sad that there was seemed to be some attempts at her history was being erased, like no one cared enough about it. I think that another aspect of this is that this is actually not just with, you know, Jonas, but like, it's just like a very universal thing. Like, I mean, for example, I come from a very biological background, and I'm sure everyone has heard the story about Rosalind Franklin and how she basically found out the DNA, like the structure of the DNA helix, but then obviously the credits were, people didn't credit her. These two men, scientists, got the Nobel Prize, being credited for finding the structure of the DNA helix. It's not just a religious institution, it's also science institutions. And if we talk about it outside of the West as well, I have a friend who does gender studies. She studied gender studies at uni, and we were talking about it because she was looking at gender from a South Asian perspective, and I was also thinking about it from the East Asian perspective. And what we discovered was that when you look at historical records, you always find like men's names, and you don't find like many women's names when it comes to, you know, revolutionaries and things like that, even though if you try and really, really look at the archives and listen to like oral stories and histories and stuff, you do have women who participated. So it almost seems like it really depends, like the erasure of women in like important like historical records is like a universal thing. And I wonder if it's something that happens because of patriarchy being a universal thing, and men are the ones who sort of like set the historical narrative universally, and whether it's a thing of, well, it's institutional and systemic, isn't it? So we should probably challenge that, and maybe more women would come to light, maybe.
Yeah. So absolutely right. And Rosalind Franklin actually was one character that I thought we could do as part of this Jewish women series, because she was also Jewish. I think to be fair to the Nobel Prize committee, Watson and Crick received the Nobel Prize when Rosalind Franklin had already died, and you can't win the Nobel Prize when you're dead anymore. So we can at least give that to the Nobel Prize committee that they weren't totally terrible. Although, of course, the way that scientific history is told, she's very much forgotten, and actually very interesting life, unfortunately, very short life. Rosalind Franklin died aged 37. But yeah, absolutely, your point absolutely is right. And it's one of the reasons why I'm interested in this series as well, is I think as an egalitarian movement, we should challenge ourselves still to think, have we as liberal Judaism actually done enough to make sure that we aren't complicit in this forgetting of women's contributions, women's lives, and so on. Thank you so much. David, you wanted to come in.
Wondering about why she was forgotten. Do we know anything of her demeanour? Did she have some sort of attitude that put people off and therefore people wanted to forget her or what? Do we know anything about her demeanour?
We have her letters, she seems to have positive relationships with people, and there are a few accounts of very complimentary accounts of how much people appreciated her pastoral skills, especially. I think her somebody in the chat mentioned Rabbi Eliezer Klapik in her book, which I hadn't yet mentioned, but Rabbi Eliezer Klapik wrote a book, a biography about Fräulein Rabbina Jonas. It's available in English. It's a really fantastic book portraying the whole story. But she sort of did a lot of research trying to trace a little bit the relationships. I think what we can definitely say is that much like what we find with a lot of other women who break out of the mold, there are things that are said about them that are not complimentary, right? Because she probably had to display a lot of traits and fight for her place, which isn't always easy. And, you know, to be a woman in a world where, as she talked about, beauty and womanhood and motherhood are celebrated, not to conform with that makes you not quite fit in. And she entered a world where she, you know, didn't quite fit in. She was the odd one out. So, of course, that was possibly also contributed, that people just, the people she had close relationships, and we have to also remember, it might have been completely different had it not been for the fact that also many of her contemporaries were murdered, right? It's not just that she died, many of her contemporaries were murdered. I think we also have to sort of be sympathetic to those who maybe didn't keep her memory alive, is that a lot of them spent a long time trying to forget those years, right? You didn't really want to think back to 1938, to 1942, 1943. Mm. What is interesting is, and this is something where I think it's interesting also, she didn't fit the mold of, you know, the other women. So what is interesting is there is a book about Jewish women in Terezin, which was written at a time where we already know about her again, and she's not really mentioned. Because there she doesn't fit the mold, right? She wasn't a she was a woman in a man's world. And she was like, she tried to be in the traditional religious world. She tried to be traditional. She was, you know, a revolutionary who wanted to be traditional. So she's caught in this in between, I think. And that, I think, adds to the complexity. Rachel, I think you wanted to...
Thank you for the comprehensive answer, Leah.
Sorry, I think it didn't unmute. Sorry, Rachel.
Okay, I mean, I think you've partly spoken to what I was going to say, but I just feel that perhaps we're almost overcomplicating this in the sense that, you know, through the Holocaust, so many things happened that people did not want to talk about afterwards. And if you look at the Israelis, and I have this on good authority from an Israeli when I was there, there were a whole generation of people, young people, who grew up bearing the names of their dead siblings. And it was never discussed. The parents never told them anything about the experiences in the camp or exactly when these children were born or, you know, what their characters were like. But then you get this sort of enforced thing in this case where the children feel they have to be perfect because they're fulfilling hopes and dreams that never happened with the children before. So it may be as simple as it was just such a painful topic in a relatively short life, you know, that people just didn't want to discuss it or didn't discuss it. I would say they didn't want to. It wasn't what you did. You had to move forward, or you kind of had let the Holocaust, the Nazis win by dragging you down into the mire. I don't know. Just a thought.
Yeah, thank you. I think really thank you for these reflections. I think there's, you know, in many ways we can only hypothesize. But I think you point to something very true. You know, it was a time of trauma also that people wanted to forget. I think at the same time, I do think though, there was a sort of, we don't really want to let that genie out of the box thing still. Because I mean, if you speak with Rabbi Jackie Tabak, and actually Rabbi Jackie Tabak is presenting next week herself, not about herself, although she could do in a sense a session about herself even. But she's talking about Licorice of Winchester, who is the most ancient in our series that of women that we are presenting. But you know, even during Jackie Tabak's career, Rabbi Tabak didn't have a very easy career to start off with. There were synagogues who said very clearly, she's not going to be on our bimah. So I think it is a combination of a couple of things. I just found a lovely quote, which I should probably add in addition to what was asked earlier about her kind of popularity. There is one account actually where it says that by 1938, when after Kristallnacht, when many of the men had been thrown into concentration camps. So in November 1938, during what we know as Kristallnacht in English, well, in English, German, taking the German word, nobody in Germany, by the way, calls it Kristallnacht anymore. People talk about Reichspogromnacht. But many of the men were thrown into concentration camps, including many of the rabbis. A lot of them were released again, and then some of them managed to escape. But so she became a very popular preacher, and apparently she became so popular that she managed to fill every place to capacity, and those who did not manage to get in stood in the doorway as far as the street. So clearly she had some appeal. maybe she wasn't always the easiest person necessarily, but she definitely had some appeal. Unfortunately, it's really been so wonderful to have this opportunity to spend an hour with Rabbi Regina Jonas and with you. Unfortunately, our time is coming to an end. I wanted to share, to conclude this session, just share a few words again by Rabbi Regina Jonas from that sermon that she gave, and it's the only sermon that remains from her time in Theresienstadt. We're not entirely sure exactly when the sermon is from. It's not dated, but I wanted to share with you anyway this short quote, because it's a beautiful quote and shows a little bit the beauty of her writing. I'm gonna share the screen, just sometimes it's easier for people to be able to follow if they can also see the text. And so she says there, "Our Jewish people is sent from God into history as blessed. To be blessed by God means wherever one steps in every life situation, to give blessing, kindness, and faithfulness. Men and women, women and men, have undertaken this duty with the same Jewish faithfulness. Our work in Theresienstadt, serious and full of trials as it is, also serves this end, to be God's servants, and as such to move from earthly spheres to eternal ones. May all our work be a blessing for Israel's future and the future of humanity. Upright Jewish men and brave noble women were always the sustainer of our people. May we be found worthy by God to be numbered in the circle of these women and men. May all our work, which we have tried to perform as God's servants, be a blessing for Israel's future and humanity. And with that, I say thank you so much. And don't miss the session next week with Rabbi Jackie Tabak, herself the first woman to be ordained in Britain, talking about the most important Jewish woman of medieval Britain, Licoricia of Winchester. Thank you so much for being with us. Thank you so much for signing up for the series. If you have any questions or comments afterwards still, my email is just rabbilea@arksynagogue.org. So feel free, I'll put that in the chat. Feel free to send me a message if you want to continue the conversation. And otherwise, I'm going to say good night, and it's been an absolute pleasure.